My name is Alicia Dwyer Cianciolo, and I'm an aerospace engineer at the NASA Langley Research Center. I'm originally from Northeast Nebraska. I grew up on a ranch. I think I knew at about 5 years old that this isn't the kind of job that I wanted to do. I remember being a kid in the middle of nowhere, so there was, we were 20 miles from the closest town, so there was no light pollution. So the thing that got me, I think, interested in NASA was being able to go out every night and look up at the stars, and you really could confuse lightning bugs with satellites because, you know, you could see everything. You could see a movement across the sky. So I think that was my first interaction with, you know, the awe and wonder of space and what's out there. I never really knew what I really liked to do, but I also knew what I was good at, and I was really bad at spelling, but I really liked math and science, and so I took those classes. And when I went to, when I graduated from high school, I decided to go to college, and the only real science that I didn't require a whole lot of spelling was physics, and so I got into that and I really liked it, and did my undergraduate in physics. About the year between my junior and senior year, it was 1997, and that was the year that the Mars Pathfinder landed on Mars, the very first rover that we'd ever sent to Mars. And it was also the time when the internet was becoming, you know, more mainstream and people started having it in their houses. And I was working at school, I was going to summer school that summer. And so I had access to it, and my friends and I, we would follow it. And like, how fascinating is this to see a rover, you know, on Mars? And one of my friends was like, you know, I think you could do that. You know, I'm like, no, I don't know anybody who works at NASA. You know, they're all in the movies and they're all, and he's like, no, I think, you know. So we started doing some online searches for summer programs because I was going to try to do an internship the following summer. And I found the summer program internship here at NASA Langley. And through that program, I learned about a graduate program that was also at the center, and I applied and was accepted. And so my very first job task in the graduate program was to put an orbiter around Mars. So who lets graduate students get to do that? It's pretty neat. My first real job after I was hired as a civil servant was the Mars Odyssey orbiter. We did a thing, part of the mission called aerobraking, where you use the atmosphere to achieve a science orbit. So you gradually reduce it from a highly elliptical to a circular orbit. The reason we use it is to save propellant. So you can only put so much mass on a spacecraft to launch it and send it to Mars. And so when you have the option of sending scientific instruments or propulsion, we usually want to maximize the amount of science that we can do. And so to do that, we'll take a small amount of propellant and use it as soon as we get to the planet and put it in a very large elliptical orbit. And then what we'll do is, once it's in that, then we'll do little tiny maneuvers that don't use very much propellant and lower the periapsis, which is the closest approach to the planet, just a little bit into the atmosphere so that we can use the drag on the solar arrays to slow it down. And then we were able to apply that information that we learned from that mission to the next one in 2005, was the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter. And in between time, they sent the Spirit and Opportunity rovers to the surface in 2004. And so I was part of the team that worked on the entry, descent, and landing for that. Entry, descent, landing is the phase of a Mars mission that delivers the spacecraft from the top of the atmosphere to the surface. And because Mars is so different than Earth, you can't land things like an airplane. And so we actually have different phases of flight. We have the entry portion where you're going very fast and your spacecraft heats up a lot. So you need some kind of thermal protection against that. But then once it gets through the heat pulse, there's not enough atmosphere to keep slowing it down. So then you need some other kind of drag device. And in the small robotic missions, we've been using parachutes. But as we get to larger and larger missions, we think we're going to have to come up with some different ways to slow it down in that particular region of the atmosphere. And then as you get very close to the surface, then, you know, if you're just on a parachute, you're going way too fast to land, so we usually turn on engines to slow you down. So it's really a kind of a three-phase process. It's three very distinct areas of research that have to go into developing the systems that do that. So now that I've spent a decade working on robotic missions to Mars, the next thing we want to do is try to send humans to Mars. And so we know that to send humans, it's going to take a lot more stuff because humans require a lot more stuff to live there. And so we've landed one metric ton with the Mars Curiosity rover. We think that to support a, you know, colonization of Mars for humans, we're going to have to land things that are on the order of like 20 metric ton. The reason we use mass instead of weight is because weight is different depending on where you are in the solar system. And so we actually run into this problem a lot with the engine folks who like to measure thrust to weight of the engine. So the amount of thrust that comes from the engines over the weight of the whole vehicle that is trying to land. And the problem is that all the engines are designed in Earth and Earth Gs. And when we take them to Mars and they have to operate in Mars Gs, we all have to just make sure that we define the difference. Where if you're using mass, 1 kilogram is 1 kilogram on Earth and on Jupiter and on Mars. And so it helps us to all speak the same language because we can convert weight once we know where we're at. But it's really important to know what units you're working in. And so what we're trying to do now is help NASA be smart investors in what technologies they should invest in so that we can make that happen. The design process is very important, and that's why it took us about 10 years. I worked on the Curiosity rover for about 10 years because the portion that I work on is the computer simulation portion, where we take all the models from the aerodynamicists and the parachute people and the mass properties of the actual rover, and we put it in a simulation, and we have to guarantee to, you know, like a 99%, you know, when you run 10,000 cases that, you know, 99% of them will be successful and it will land where you want it to land. And there were lots of times when it didn't through the design process. So we would tell them, well, to make it land here, you're going to either need to add more propellant or you'll need a bigger parachute. So then it's a conversation. We start working with the engineers building it and the parachute people who are building the parachute to try to, make all the pieces fit into a design that actually works. The things that we're doing are not written in books, and we can't just go look up a solution somewhere. So it's a lot of trial and error. And it's just like when we used the airbags for the Mars Exploration Rover's Spirit and Opportunity, and we tried to use that for Curiosity, and we were finding that they were breaking all the time. So we had to come up with a new solution to land that rover because the way we did it before wasn't going to work. So what we decided on was the sky crane. But there were lots of iterations that took us to get to that point. And we didn't know, even when we designed that, if it was going to work because we'd never actually flown anything like it at Mars. So there's a lot of risk in trying new things, but we would have never been able to do what we did if we would have been afraid to try. And it just so happened that, you know, I ended up coming to NASA at the beginning of a decade of unprecedented Mars exploration, where, you know, timing really was everything. And because of that, I got to participate in all of the missions that happened that decade. With the exception of one, the Phoenix lander was a competed mission. And so I competed against it. And so mine lost and my colleagues won. So we're all happy for them anyway. But I worked on the Curiosity entry, descent, and landing team. And I'm currently working on the InSight entry, descent, landing team. So, and the MAVEN mission that's going on now, we're working on that too. So yeah, you can't plan this. It just worked out. My advice to somebody in middle school, and it's advice I give my own middle schoolers, I have two at home, is to, one, find what you love to do and be really good at it. Whatever you decide, you're doing. And know that it's okay to fail, because sometimes we learn more when we do fail, and that it's a process that it, you know, we need to make environments where it's okay to do that, because then you come back and you evaluate what did you learn in that. As far as, you know, doing what you're good at, sometimes is what you like to do and sometimes isn't. But it helps if what you're good at is something that you enjoy doing. And I think maybe most of it is just just recognizing in yourself what you don't like. I didn't know I wanted to work at NASA. I just knew that I didn't want to stay on the farm and the ranch. So, you know, knowing and being able to recognize that in yourself, I think is a big help, so that when you are presented with opportunities, then you can take the ones that feel right and fit right with you. what I love about my job is being able to go out and talk to, you know, university students and just the public and let them know that, you know, we really are working on these things. We get paid to do really cool stuff and that they can do it too. It's not something that, you know, you have to have this gene and you're born to work here. No, it's everybody finds what they love to do. And we do need people to help us solve these problems.